This is the Jim Fannon Show on Niagara's News Talk 610. Call now, 905-688-2582, 1-877-610-2582, or text us at 610-10.
Sunday 12 to 2. I am your Sunday scrub. Do you recognize that intro? That is the Marantz Project. Local band here. Chris Crawford, Craig Ritchie, Dan O'Shea on drums, Tom Nems on bass, and the beautiful lyrics of Sarah Beattie. Nice job. Riley Cote, thanks for the love. That was a great conversation talking sports, hockey, and hemp. On the phone with me now, Bart Maves is your nominated candidate for the riding of Niagara Falls, also an elected regional councillor. Bart, I appreciate your time on a crappy day like this. Thanks for coming into the Jim Fannon Show.
It's my pleasure, Jim. I wish I could have come into the studio and sit with you. Maybe we can do that another day.
Definitely.
But, I'm busy digging out here from fallen tree branches and whatnot. It's an ugly day.
Yeah, well, you're not the only one. Joyce Morocco sent her regrets as well. I was going to have you guys go head-to-head, maybe have Gates, and you guys have your first unofficial debate right here at the 610 CKTV studios. Tell me a little bit about the issues facing you in the Niagara Falls riding.
Well, the biggest thing clearly is jobs in Niagara Falls. Niagara Falls riding takes into account Fort Erie, Niagara Falls, and Niagara Lake. And across the whole region, we've probably suffered in the last decade and certainly the last 5 or 6 years more than any other region in the province with lost jobs, especially lost manufacturing jobs. And we need to get a lot of work done to stem the tide of loss of jobs, repair our economy. More people working means more people paying taxes, which will help you balance your budget and help you pay for services that you need. So that's the number one issue by far.
Bart Maves is my guest on the phone. He's your nominated candidate for the upcoming by-election, the vacancy created by the resignation, the untimely resignation of Kim Crater, a much-loved MPP there in Niagara Falls. What do you think, Bart, your winnability of that riding looks like? I mean, you got some stiff competition. You got possibly a couple city councilors going up together. Hey, this might turn out to be the debate of, you know, regional versus municipal, all municipal councilors going head to head here.
Well, as you said earlier, it remains to be seen who the other candidates are.
Right.
They don't have officially a candidate yet. The Liberals announced that Joyce, who I've known both Joyce and Wayne, who you've mentioned for 20 years, get along quite well with both of them. They're good folks, but no one's a candidate yet. And the Liberals did an extensive search and recently announced Joyce as their preferred, which is just, I've never seen that before.
It's ridiculous.
And then they said they were going to have a nomination, but they didn't announce a nomination date. So it's a odd situation there. And
well, now I heard that what they've done is they've retroactively closed nominations dating back to what, last Saturday or something like that. So even if you did want to put your nomination forward, oops, we already skewed it, so you can't put your name forward. Frank Rosso, I'm talking to you.
The Liberal Party of Ontario has different systems than the rest of us. And we have a system where we have a nomination, we have candidate searches, we come up with two, three, four candidates who may be interested, and then the local party would set a nomination date several months, ahead. And those candidates would work as hard as they can to sign up party members and get party members to support them at a nomination meeting. And we have no possibility of the central party, which Toronto and is what we usually refer to it, that they cannot appoint a candidate and they don't intervene in that local democratic process. The Liberals don't have those practices. They have them in their constitution, but they have all kinds of ways where they appoint candidates and intervene in the processes, like they did in the London West by-election, where they appointed the head of the teachers' union to become the candidate, which didn't meet very well with the local Liberals in London, and I think that candidate ended up getting about 15% of the vote in London. So I think the democratic process, get the local members, local party members involved, and I think it works best, and we went through that process. We had over 1,000 people come to our nomination meeting last January, and that's good spirited
wow.
democratic process.
That's
too bad
good participation.
The parties don't follow it.
Absolutely. Bart Maves is my guest. Now, Bart, don't take this the wrong way, but it's a fluid situation in that riding right now. We don't have a date for the by-election yet. When I saw Premier Wynne come into town and all the energy that Andrea Horvath is pouring into the Niagara region, specifically the Niagara Falls riding, I mean, they've got the big guns out. Tell me what's different this time around that wasn't maybe in place last time. I mean, you lost twice to Kim Crater, once in 2003 and then once in 2007. Some of those were close. I think 3,000 votes you lost by the first time. With your party leader, Tim Hudak's seemingly unelectability and the strength of the NDP right now, how do you think your chances are different than they have been in the past of winning that riding?
Well, you know, every election has its own dynamic, whether it's a general or a by-election. 2003 election was, we had come off 8.5 years of government and you know, sometimes people in Ontario and in Canadian elections look for change after governments have been in power for a certain amount of time. And I think that one was our first one under Ernie Eves, and I think that's what that one was about. 2007 was our, I guess, infamous John Tory election with John came up with a schools policy that did not meet favorably with the electorate, never has whenever it's been attempted in Ontario politics, and I think that's the issue that dominated that election. This one is, you know, the Liberals are going to have, I think, a great deal of difficulty. The public, when I've been going out door to door for the past month and a half, and even earlier in the summertime, there's a great deal of frustration with the Liberals. The $1.1 billion completely wasted on gas plants and the orange scandal, the e-health before that, and it just goes on and on. There's a great deal of frustration with public watching the Liberals just waste their money and mishandle it. The lack of jobs, the huge debts and deficits that have been piling up, they're doubling deficits that Bob Rae ran back in the 90s when we all thought Bob Rae would be the worst and the NDP of 1995 would be the worst fiscal performance by an Ontario government in the history of the province. But McGuinty and Wynne and the Liberals are outdoing them. So I think there's a great deal of frustration there, and people want change from that direction. And the NDP, frankly, have propped them up for the past 3 years. So
indeed,
a lot of people recognize that if they don't like what the Liberals have done, especially in the last 3 years, some of the blame has to lay at the feet of the NDP because they've been supporting them every step of the way.
Bart Maves is my guest. Bart, on the way out, just give me your take on what's happening at Regional Council and the seemingly lack of functionality that we're experiencing at that level right now.
Well, I honestly, at the regional level, I think we're kind of divided, not on all things. I mean, a lot of items get done and a lot of things get passed that, you know, people don't talk about because they go smoothly. But there's a bit of a split, I guess, of people who've been there for a long time, an old guard, new guard split. And I think some of the people that are newer councillors elected for the first time to regional council in 2010 are looking to change the direction of the region in many different ways. And we don't have a majority, so we push for those changes, and we can't always get them through. And sometimes we do. But I think there's that dynamic that goes on of desire for change from some and not from others, and that's generally where it seems to split out.
Bart, I really appreciate your time on a crappy day like today, and we'll get you in when we've got some more time, maybe give you some more time once everyone's nominated, but I appreciate your time and your takes. We'll touch you up soon. Thanks, Bart.
Thank you, Jim.
That was Bart Maves. He is the only nominated candidate for that riding in Niagara Falls for the upcoming by-election to replace Kim Crater. I'm going to have a discussion with Wayne Gates. We talked to him yesterday. He's at the Bills game today. Nicely done, Gates. I wanted to get him in the booth, but he came in yesterday after his granddaughter's play in St. Catharines here. I got 5 or 6 segments. We could take 2 hours with this guy, but I'm going to give you the first couple segments of my interview with Gatesy, Mr. Wayne Gates of Unifor, local 199 used to be. Gates will be up after this. This is 610 CKTB.
You may contain the urge to run away, but hold her down with soggy clothes and breeze blocks.
This is the Jim Fannon Show on Niagara's News Talk 610. Call now, 905-688-2582, 1-877-610-2582, or text us at 610-10.
Welcome back. I'm Jim Fannon. My thanks to Bart Maves for coming in. Nicely done, Bart. Good luck to you. He is your only nominated candidate in the riding of Niagara Falls. We had a stacked deck today, and the weather blew it apart. Joyce Morocco sends her regrets. She's been up most of the night mopping her basement and taking calls from Niagara Falls city residents with flooded basements. I managed to escape that, although we lost power for a great deal of the night last night. I'm your Sunday scrub. Every Sunday, noon to 2, we're right here. We're live. We're taking your calls. You have the digits. You know how to get in. Following up on our conversation with Bart Maves, what is going on in the riding of Niagara Falls? This is going to be a really interesting election to watch. It's already interesting. You see the Liberals coming to town, pouring a whole bunch of resources into that riding, handpicking a candidate and saying, Joyce Morocco is our preferred candidate. When's the last time somebody was a preferred candidate? And then as of 10 p.m. last night, the Ontario Liberal Party of Ontario retroactively terminated the candidate search for the Niagara Falls riding. Retroactively to last Saturday, and they put one name forward. That's it for their nomination meeting. Where's the democracy in that? Crying out loud. This is supposed to be the new Liberal Party. Stinks like McGuinty's old party. I'm all for getting behind a candidate. I would rather see a little bit more democratic process followed. But this is the Liberal Party, and Horvath so that they haven't chosen their Niagara Falls candidate yet. The nomination committee has spoken to Wayne Redekop. We're all familiar with him and Wayne Gates. And the two men have run for the NDP in the past. Gates federally, as we know. Talked to Wayne Gates yesterday. I'm going to play a segment from our interview, maybe two if we're running out of time quickly here. Sorry about that. Interesting conversation with Wayne Gage yesterday. We'll get to that after 1:30. Here's my take on this. First, and I'm kind of vacillated a little bit. First, I see Wynn coming to town. That's powerful. Joyce Morocco looks good up behind the lectern with the premier. It's a powerful endorsement when you're in power and you can afford as premier to come. I think she jogged down here. by the YouTube commercials that I've been seeing lately. Comes down, handpicks her candidate. I'm like, ooh, this is momentum. And at first, I'm like, well, this might not be, this is a big hill to climb here. Liberals might run away with this. Now I've shifted. I think the Liberals are going to get punished at the polls in this riding. In this by-election, they're scandal-plagued, their integrity is lacking, and look at their nomination meeting. This kind of speaks to it. I don't want to unfairly go after Joyce Morocco. She sends her regrets, can't make it in because of the weather. But I think they're going to get punished at the polls. The last provincial election was Hudak's to lose, and what happened? He lost it. I remember coming on Tom McConnell's show as a caller, Monday to Friday, 9 to 12, and saying, Premier-elect Hudak. I was already calling this guy the Premier-elect, like he already had won it. And then for whatever reason, the wheels fell off that cart, and he choked it away. Bart Maves, we spoke to earlier, run a couple times in that riding, lost twice to Kim Crater. I think this is the opportunity for the NDP to squirt up the middle, and in fact, that is my prediction. The unelectability of the Liberals and the Conservatives bodes well for Horvath and Gates if he ever announces that he's in. And I spoke to him yesterday. After this break, we'll play part of that interview. This is 610 CKTB.
This is the Jim Fannon Show on Niagara's News Talk 610. Call now, 905-688-2582, 1-877-610-2582, or text us at 610-10.
Wayne, thanks for taking the time. Just for our listeners that may not know who you are, maybe just give us a brief intro. Who are you and why the hell do you do this, brother?
Well, obviously it's Wayne Gates. I'm president of Unifor Local 199, have been for the last 11 years. I've been elected as a union rep in the General Motors plant for over 30 years. And I had the privilege and the honor with the support of the Niagara Falls residents 3 years ago to become a city councilor of Niagara Falls, which I'm extremely proud of.
Why? Well, no, why not why are you proud, but why? I mean, public life is a tough life, and you've been, you said 30 years, over 30 years, mm-hmm. elected by the GM employees. It takes something, man. You put a little bit of a target on your back by stepping up to the plate, being behind the lectern and delivering your platform. So what appeals to public life, and why be elected as a city councillor, first of all?
Well, I've always wanted to be a city councilor. I always wanted to have a say in how the city is run. I like to make the city better for our kids and our grandkids. So I think that part was easy. As far as the union part go, we've always needed a strong voice, somebody that is fair and reasonable, to be able to sit across from different employees, not just General Motors, by the way. We, in Unifor, Local 199, we've got 20 workplaces that we represent. I think it's important to be able to sit across and hammer out fair collective agreements that, quite frankly, allow the business to make money. And then allow that the their employees share in that wealth that's being created by the members. On the other flip side of that, I think you need a strong voice for the community, strong voice to talk about issues that are important, like you did just last week with community care. Mm-hmm. And the needs that are in our community, where those with the less fortunate, you know, 1 in 6 kids today are going to bed hungry. So you need a voice. You need somebody that's wants to make sure that the less fortunate, the middle class, is certainly taken care of. And I believe that over the last number of years, I've been able to do that.
So making a difference is key. I mean, you're not doing this for your own healthy ego, or, I mean, you're not just a guy that searches the spotlight. You're actually thinking you can make a difference in this town by running for politics?
Well, I actually did. I mean, I'm not going to deny anything. I was one of those kids that was collecting pop bottles in Port Dalhousie when I was 5 years old, because we didn't have anything at that point in time in our lives with our family and our parents.
Financially,
and,
you mean?
Yes, and somebody said at that time, you know what? Let's give the Gates family a hand up. And over the course of the, you know, my next 60 years on Earth, I think it's worked out well. But if somebody didn't take that responsibility and say let's give them a helping hand, let's make a difference, and here we are, you know, 60 years later, I continue to say thanks all the time, because somebody took the time to take care of us, and I want to make sure till the day I die I'm doing the same thing.
Now, I guess I could fairly describe you as left of the political spectrum. As far as, have you been affiliated with the NDP officially before?
I've been affiliated with the NDP for a while. I've ran federally twice.
You did run federally twice. I should know that. I should do my homework before I get the guest in. But
No, that's fine. I ran twice against Mr. Nicholson from the Conservative Party, and
He's got a huge political machine, man.
Listen, it's I've always said, and it's interesting when you talk about party politics. People come up to me and they'll say, well, you know, you're an NDP or you're a liberal and you're a conservative. I always look at it that I believe that the country or my city should be run one way. Somebody that's a liberal may think it should be run a different way. And somebody that's conservative says, no, I think the province or the country should be run this way. It doesn't mean you're a bad person because you're an NDP or a liberal or a conservative. You just feel in your heart that there's a better way to run the country or the province. And I've always thought that, I think the debates are fun, trying to get a message out. And at the end of the day, you always have to respect people that vote. And they'll choose what they think is in the best interest probably of themselves, but probably more importantly what they think is in the best interest of their family and their kids and their grandkids.
Agreed. Now tell me about your experience with the NDP. I've noticed, as just a political watcher, and obviously I've been identified as being green, run 5 or 6 times, ran for the leadership. I'm retired. I don't carry a card anymore. I love the green platform. I'm not, the biggest fan of Elizabeth May, the internal workings of it. We haven't had a leadership in a long time, and I've come from the school of smack your own. Like, if you deserve props, you'll get it. Tell me about the support that you got with the NDP, because I know the NDP have been typically, I've seen them walk away from a few candidates that they felt, the central party I'm talking about, they felt couldn't win against a monster like Rob Nicholson. Did you get support? Did they come to your back, or did they kind of walk away from you?
No, you know what? I have nothing but good things to say. I had the privilege, and with what's transpired over the last number of years, it was actually an honor. Mr. Layton, the late Jack Layton, was the leader. He treated me with the utmost respect. I could call him anytime I want and talk about
Well, you're issues. A player in this town, and if you can't get Jack's here.
No, but I think to your point, they knew, they knew like I knew. I wasn't going to beat Mr. Nicholson. It wasn't going to happen. But they treated me with respect. They gave me the resources that I need.
They did, eh?
If I had a question that I wasn't sure of or part of our platform, I could call and somebody would call me back. And, I've always loved Jack, because he's always treated me like I was, special. And I believe he did that with everybody.
I think he had a way of doing that, for sure.
He had a way of doing that. And so I considered a real honor to have carried the NDP flag against, like I said, Mr. Nicholson twice. I was able to get out a message that I thought was important to get out. At the end of the day, no, I didn't win. I think it's one thing me and you probably got in common. We've ran a number of times and haven't won. And that's just what happens. But if you have a belief that this is a better thing to do, it's going to be a better society, I think you put your hand up and you run. The voters choose on who they want to vote for. So I have nothing but good things to say about when I ran as a NDP candidate, and certainly Mr. Layton treated me with respect, and so did the party, and they always have.
Good. Now we're talking about that, intentions for Niagara Falls. So you're hotly rumored to be the NDP, somebody that's seeking the NDP nomination in Niagara Falls riding. We've seen this preferred quote, and I'm using air quotes. I can't hear that on air or see that on air, but this preferred candidacy is just incredibly, outside the box for me. I know it happens all the time. Parties choose their candidates. I get that. I'm not happy with the Liberal Party's blocking of other candidates, because I know guys like Frank Rasso came to the Liberal Party and said, I want to run. And they're, well, thanks, but no thanks. We've got our candidate already. So that kind of reeks. So I think that, you know, Joyce obviously has her work cut out for her, not for the nomination, but for to get elected in that riding. And that'll all play itself out. But what are your intentions? Can you announce right now that you're going to seek the nomination?
No, I can't. I can't announce that right now. But I've been very clear over the last six to eight weeks that I'm seriously considering running. I would if I decide to do that. I would expect that the party will have a nomination meeting. I'd have to win the nomination. Have our members vote. I don't want to be a preferred candidate, by the way. I believe that the riding association should choose who they think should represent them in the upcoming election. So if I decide to do that, there'll be a nomination meeting. My understanding, they're trying to organize that probably as we're having this interview. And obviously, I'll make my decision up pretty soon.
What are you waiting for, Wayne? Why not just say, yeah, I'm going to run? When the nomination race is declared, I am your guy. Because I see it this way. The first guy out of the box usually has an advantage. And, dude, if you put your name forward, there's going to be all kinds of other guys that say, I'm not running against Gatesy. Are you crazy? I'll never win that. I mean, he's going to bring all his union guys to the meeting. He's got the NDP sewn up in this town. They can't beat you. So why not declare now and rule these guys out?
Well, the reality is that I'm having a lot of talk with my family.
That is such a standard answer from you politicians.
But you know what? I can appreciate that. But, you know, the reality is...
there's no one in your family that's going to say, Wayne, really, I think you need to sit this one out. Come on. You wear the pants at home.
I'm going to tell you that I have the utmost respect for my family and my extended family as well. And when you take a look at, you know, I'm not going to sit here. I've got... I'm a president of a major union in the area. And I said this earlier. I'm absolutely honored and thrilled that I'm a city councilor in Niagara Falls. I enjoy working with Mayor Jim Diodati. I think he's a young, bright man that has a lot of enthusiasm. The council, I can't speak for other councils, but our council works extremely well.
Pretty functional,
together.
Yeah.
I believe that we like each other. And what I like about the council is, I may say something on an issue and they might not agree, but it's professional. It's not, we're not trying to run each other down or
not, at the region. Is that what you're afraid? Not
afraid. They're certainly, they're allowing you to have your opinion
good.
We have our votes. So in my life today, I'm happy being president of Unifor 199. I'm thrilled. I tell you, every day I'm thrilled that I'm a counselor. My issue is I want to make sure that my family will do it, but I do know in my heart what's going on with some of the positions that are taken by the other parties. We're going to need a voice, and we're going to need a strong voice, and I think we're going to need one that's got some passion and heart. And if anything works out, maybe I'll be that candidate.
Great. Wayne Gates is my guest. On the other side, we'll talk a little bit more about the Niagara Falls ride. Man, we got stuff. We could go all day on this stuff. We got racetrack, the so-called Southern Tier Hospital or the Niagara Falls Hospital, manufacturing casino. More with my guest, Wayne Gates, after this.
This is the Jim Fannon Show on Niagara's News Talk 610. Call now, 905-688-2582, 1-877-610-2582, or text us at 610-10. And when I do, my mind starts to reel, is this the way that I should feel, is this the way that I should feel? Is there a need to be concerned? Have they done studies? What have they learned? What have they learned? I fear that soon I'll lose my nerve. Well,
Welcome back. This is my disorder, being behind the microphone. Gratitude to all the guests that come in today. Riley Cooper just sends me a text. Thanks, man. I'm on my way now. Little tailgate action, 66 degrees in Philadelphia. He's on his way down to the game that starts at 8:30. Brother, nicely done. Man, I wish I was down watching the Eagles take apart the Bears tonight. 8:30. Win, and we win the division. Thanks, Riles. Thanks, Wayne Gates. Thanks to Joyce Morocco. She had to send her regrets today because of the weather and a broken sleep last night. Many calls from Niagara Falls residents and a leaky basement, apparently. And my thanks to Bart Maves for coming in as well. I wish I had some more time for the candidates here, but we ran long with Riley Cote. What a great interview. Talking NHL hockey, headshots, Bettman's new league, Shanahan's new disciplinarian. He's a disciplinarian. Handing out the discipline to the guys that are walking away from the code and the respect that used to exist. Much gratitude to my guest tonight. I am Jim Fannon. Additional ways that you can interact with the show, as always, on Twitter, where at 610CKTB. At Jim Fannon, include me in that, F-A-N-N-O-N. You want to pump up the Tom McConnell Show at the TMC Show on Twitter. We got into a Twitter spat last night about Tommy's aversion for eating pizza sandwiches. Pizza is not designed to be eaten as a sandwich, Tommy. A little bit of a fun segment on the way out. Tommy's show, best show of the year, in my opinion, was Friday. Caller of the year. I love caller-on-caller action. And I think I was the first one to make it okay. Came out of the box slamming the other callers. Love it. And I take mine. I get it. Tom McConnell Show, as you know, runs Monday to Friday here on 610 CKTB, 9 to 12. Friday, the caller of the year action had Brian the Rock, as he was glossed by the studio, unlike Hugo, which self-glossed himself. You can't nickname yourself Pat from Barry. It's not cool. I would like to be called Hugo. Brian the Rock against Clarice at 2 minutes to 12 Friday. We have a tie. A what? A tie between The Rock and Clarice. You know how many listeners are going to be looking for a shower rod if Clarice wins Caller of the Year. Come on. A few years ago, I actually voted for Clarice. Went looking for said shower rod because I thought, oh no, what if my vote puts her over? I won. I was Caller of the Year. 3 years running, I think. We skipped a year. London came on board. Tommy didn't run it. So I had a two-year reign. And then I won again. Arnie gets pissed and starts campaigning like a madman last year and wins. He's begging all his Facebook friends and all his guys with similar-looking vests to vote for him for Call of the Year. Pandering to the listenership. We had a lot of fun with that. I shared a couple of his Facebook posts on Friday. Vote for me for Caller of the Year. And then I guess I got him all bent because he didn't show up to the after party. The best part of Caller of the Year, well, usually for me, is going to get my crown afterwards. Having everyone come up and tell me how great I am. I got disqualified this year, and I have officially complained to management. I'm taking this to the highest level. The executive officer of Bell Media will be hearing from me Monday. I already talked to Tim Perriner about it. Bob Harris is next on my hit list. I was disqualified early in the show, unreasonably disqualified, because now I am a fill-in scrub for said Tom McConnell. So not only can I not win contests, tickets, prizes anymore. Used to have a knack for getting the odd ticket here and there. Now I just get with the garbage that's left on the kitchen table on Friday afternoons if I come in. Tommy took it upon himself to declare me ineligible for Caller of the Year. Now, I don't call as much as I used to. Only the stuff that really hits me. Mostly on Tommy's show, but once in a while with Larry. Once in a while with KJ. They'll tweak me enough and I just gotta get in. Do a crossover every Friday with Tommy at 11:35, so I don't call in for the Vox Populi anymore, but I did not expect to get sold out by a mentor of mine in Tom McConnell, having the rug pulled right out from under me and making me ineligible to even get a call. I'm not bent that I didn't win, but it would have been nice to get a couple votes. So at 12:02, I think the count was 9-9. Brian and Clarice with Annie Petrowski, I think a close second. Arnie had a lot of votes. I think he might have been in second too, but that kid with the orange crossed vest did not show up to the Mansion House afterwards. A lot of people did. Got to meet Marty, driving the food truck. Carl was a classic. Classic caller and classic character in person. Sue, second year running out. Campy was out. Plata. Cisco was out, left early. Matt. Lucy. Sabrina, Carolyn. Arnie, what happened, man? Even Nat made it out, a frequent texter to Tommy's show. Arnie, what happened? I'm so disappointed. And apparently, Pat from Barry, a.k.a. self-glossed Hugo, went completely missing. I didn't hear him a contribution from him on Friday. I thought he was bringing a poem out. He said, look out for me. Every time he gets in the batter's box and kind of wiggles his hips, digs his feet in, and stares down the pitcher, who is me, usually, and points to the fence and says, I'm going to take this yard, he disappears. What happened, Pat? What happened to Arnie? That was weak. Arnie, come correct. That's my take on Arnie hitting the basket. Going out with my son, the Hurricane. Thanks for listening. Cranked about today. Riley Cote. Nice. Riley, if you're still listening, I called you Riley Cooper. Get me Cooper next week, man. Love my Eagles this weekend against the Chicago Bears. Home at Philadelphia. Riles says it's 66 degrees down here at 2 o'clock. He's headed for the pregame tailgate down in Philly. I am your jealous Sunday scrub. This is 610 CKTB. We'll see you next Sunday. And Tommy's in Monday. Regular crew on Monday. Skeleton crew Tuesday. You know what that means. The scrub is back for Tommy. Tuesday, 9 to 12. Jones, are you on the board? Nope. He's out. And so am I. This is 610 CKTB. I'm out. Yeah, it's becoming evident. Come on, yeah. Ladies and gentlemen, break out the suit jackets and liquor. I think it's time you call me mister. I think it's time you call me mister. Yeah, and you can catch me on a Saturday morning. Feed up with the cup of Joe. Newspaper 610 on the radio. Chat with my wife.